or is this okay?
No, you're good. We're live. We're ready to go. We're back, okay. Ladies and gentlemen, live on the Philippe Matthews Show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Big, 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 big show. I sound like Ed Sullivan. Some of you are too young to even know what that is, but I am not. But I'm here with the amazing Dr. David Imhotep. He is the first person in the world to hold a Ph.D. with a specialization in ancient African history. He's the author of The First Americans Were Africans, documented evidence in his new book, Revisited, which has so much more evidence and content in it than the original edition. He's traveled the world researching for the last 30 years, searching for relevant and interesting evidence on the topic. He has also appeared on numerous television shows, including The First Time Now on the Philippe Matthews Show, radio shows across the globe, and has been featured in magazines such as the New York Times and has lectured in presentations around the world. I'm so overwhelmed and over the moon to have him. Welcome, Dr. David Imhotep.
Thank you very much for having me.
All right, so I'm also excited that you have a new book, or should I say an updated book, but it's almost like a new book because it's almost as much content in the new book as it was the original book. And we'll talk about that, but you also have a new e-course, 5-day e-course, and giving away a free chapter of the book, the introduction to the book, which we're going to talk about how people can go and get that. But here's the main topic, man. The topic is when you hear the title, The First Americans Were Africans, you automatically think, well, wait a minute, what about the Native Americans? But we all know this instinctively, maybe innately, but it's so wonderful when we get this evidence, this overwhelming evidence, that we always say we know we're the first, we know we created civilization, but somewhere along the line, we get kind of screwed up when it comes to all of these other ethnicities around the world. I won't say races because race is a construct. All these other ethnicities around the world. And so we keep forgetting that we were first, and first means first. So what I want you to do is help us unpack that and take us down the timeline first. And how did you come about wanting to do this work? What drove you to it? I know you took over where Van Sertima left off and just basically took it on steroids. Talk to us about that, but what drove you to this work?
Yeah, Dr. Ivan Van Sertima was a phenomenal human being. He's my spiritual father.
Mm.
So anything that I do, I blessings to him. The way I got into this work was during my dissertation. My dissertation committee saw that I was leaning a little bit too far to the Africans in Americas, and when I was trying to do a succinct look at ancient Africa, and that would be from the Egyptians backwards, not the Egyptians forward, because the Egyptians were the last phenomenally great. And there were some other great civilizations in Africa, like Zimbabwe, et cetera, et cetera, Timbuktu. But this subject became so heavy, they said, look, you gotta do that in another piece. So that's where this came from. It came out of my dissertation.
Wow, okay. So as they say, you've been doing this for 30 years. When did, how we met, ladies and gentlemen, we met through, matter of fact, Professor Kaba Hiawatha-Kamane called me up.
Phenomenal guy.
He's the best in the world. Best human being, best historian. Called me up and said, Philippe, do you know about Dr. David Imhotep? Because, you know, he's doing we're working with him on his book. He's doing the book Spirituality Before Religions. And so a lot of your work and research he's referencing in this book. And I said, that name sounds familiar, Professor. And then I realized that I downloaded the Kindle 3 years ago. So I already had the book. I was halfway through. And then, of course, because I'm a talk show dude, I got all these books I have to read and catch up on. So I put it down and didn't revisit and go back. But I knew the name and I knew the title because I said, oh, I've got to have that. That's that's just required. You know, this is a required book. If you are an African American or an African, you got to have this on your shelf. And so I called you up, and that's how we met. And we did our radio show last week. And so I thought it was fascinating that, you know, here is someone who has documented evidence, and you've been doing this for over 30 years of research. How did the book come about? The first version, then we'll talk about the new version that's coming out in a couple of weeks.
Well, first of all, I would have to correct. I think I gave you some wrong information. I've been in this work since the mid-90s. Before that, I was a nutritionist. And because of the laws for nutrition changing, because the dietitians got together with the doctors and they pulled a political maneuver, I was in Florida practicing, and they said that anyone who says, who has a patient or someone, a client that comes in, and if they're a nutritionist and the person says, well, I have a headache, and I tell them to take an aspirin, you could be fined $10,000 and 1 year in jail.
Wow. Okay. So you moved out of nutrition.
There was no future. You know?
Yeah, so, there was no future there.
So my second,
we're not going to reveal it on this show, but ladies and gentlemen, this man that is before you, yes, he is a doctor of ancient African ancestry, but there is another story and a legend that he is associated with that we're going to bring out later on that the entire world knows. We recently just lost, and one of the greatest athletes in human history, this man was his nutritionist. But we'll talk about that in another show, in another segment of time. So when did this book, when did you start researching this book and putting this book together and with all of this amazing evidence? Because this, I've never seen a book with so much evidence that was so evidence-based.
Yes. I started putting it together in the around 2002 through 2001.
Okay.
During my studies, I borrowed some things from them, and that was that if you want to be a success in life, you need to have evidence. Not, you don't deal with arguments, legal battles, or anything that has to do with proving a point. And what you want to do is you don't base your arguments on facts or truth, because facts and truths change. The fact is that yesterday it was pouring down rain here where I am, and that was the truth. But the facts today is it's not raining, and that's the truth. So facts and truth change. You do not want to be on a slippery slope. But evidence, if you base your arguments on evidence, you will never lose an argument.
Wow, that's incredibly powerful. Okay, so ladies and gentlemen, if you don't have the book, you can go to Amazon or the link below and get it. What you're going to see now, the original book, you're going to see the cover of a man on the book. Talk to us about the cover of that man on the first book. Who is that person?
Uh-huh. Well, in 1872, something of that nature, the English did a voyage with the first cameras, and they wanted to go to the Galapagos Islands to start taking pictures of some animals that people have seen and talked about. Some sailors came back and talked about, but they wanted them to see these animals that have never been seen before. They had a direct evolution that is far faster than regular evolution in Galapagos Islands. So they, by the way, the Galapagos Islands are south east of Hawaii. So they had to go around the Cape of Good Hope, which used to be called Cape of Bad Storms. And by the time they got down to the end, the southern tip of South America, they were running very low on supplies, food and water. So they put in there at the tip of South America, and they could not believe what they saw. They did not see Indians. They saw Africans. And this man on this picture, picture is in the I forget what museum it is in London, But I had to have that picture, because what is a picture of? It's the last generations of full-blooded Native Americans, the first Native Americans, which were Africans. So when they put in, they just couldn't believe that. So they took half their film on this fella and his people, and another half to the animals when they got to the Galapagos Islands. But what a picture it was.
I mean, what's fascinating when you see the photo, it looks like a relative that's in our family.
Mm-hmm. But he's short.
But he's short. But I mean, this is unbelievable. Now, again, we have to go back to what it means to say first means first, that we were the first on the planet. Now, we hear this all the time. And even our non-melanated scientists have said, yep, all life comes from Africa. Yet, on the flip side of that, they try to demonize and mystify Africa with the term ancient civilization, ancient Egypt, and you know, mythology and all of these bad things. Because here's the rub. The rub is that the Eurasian didn't show up until 3000 BC, and you have a book that you showed me, that again, because we're dealing with someone today talking about evidence. This is not truth or fact, this is evidence. Talk to us about that book. Talk to us about when the Eurasian actually showed up on the planet.
Okay, first I'll say that they were a derivative of blacks and whites. So let's go to the source. Africans, of course, Africans have been around, black folks, for millions of years. It's not in the bodies that we're in, brains we're in now today, but you know, they're talking about 1.6 or maybe 2 million years. However, in the last few months, they came out with an article that pushes back the birth of Homo sapiens from 200,000 years to 300,000 years. Mm-hmm. Homo sapiens with modern man, woman's brains, okay? So, this information was so phenomenal that I had to put my hand on it. And this book before I had beforehand, but it really made it relevant now. This book is around 2,200 pages, and
quick read. It's very quick read.
So you couldn't even get through the Evelyn Woods sped reading course.
Exactly. For you.
So it was written by a phenomenal gentleman, by a doctor, a Ph.D. named Cavelli Sforza. And he's one of the most well-known and celebrated geneticists in the world. He's an Italian fellow. And what he did was he wrote this book, and it's called The History and Geography of Human Genes, 2,200 pages, all right? And on page 145, it says that there was no white skin or light skin until when 3000 BC, and he's talking about genetically speaking, DNA speaking. DNA, anyone who watches CSI Miami or CSI New York, they'll know that they based everything on all the cases on evidence and the DNA evidence. And that DNA evidence they have found is 98.9% correct all the time. So this is it. The history
and geography. That's what we call unequivocal evidence.
Yes.
From a geneticist. Wow. Thank you for that. That's, you know, what I love about, you know, what I love about the personal aspect of the work that I do, because this is very personal to me, is I love filling in the blanks. Because a lot of us, many of us who watch the show, who follow the show and the work that I do, we all have read tens of thousands of books and have gone to tens and thousands of lectures, and we're trying to fill in the blanks of our of the magnitude and the magnificence of our history, because it's as you said, 1.6 million to 2 million years ago that we started, that we were chosen by the cosmos to be the life force, the original human on this planet. Well, that just kind of kills the argument, you know, with the Eurasian in terms 3000 BC, versus 1.6 to 2 million, you know, somebody just wasn't invited to the party, is what I'm trying to say. So you got to be a little angry. You got to just mix stuff up when you ain't invited to the party, you know. Right. So that's, and that's what we're dealing with. We're dealing with people who weren't invited to the party, and they have to fill in. They have to fill in their own blanks to make themselves relevant to humanity. Because, I mean, first means first, and you can't come to this planet or come on this planet and claim to be the originator of anything, because the people that were already here, everything that you are and have done and will do, is a direct derivative of those people, which is us. So let's now take that, if we could, Doc, and realize that by default, we populated the entire planet. Now, what is the evidence that we populated the entire planet? You talk about this in the book. You talk about this in the e-course. Pyramids and mounds. Talk to us about pyramids and mounds and how that is the distinction between all other humanity, that is our blueprint, fingerprint, our flag, if you will, of our existence prior to the Eurasian being on this planet.
Okay. The mounds come before the pyramids. And the mounds, you can see mounds all over Africa. In Central Africa, North Africa, you can see them as they slowly, as the Africans slowly moved into Europe 40 to 45,000 years ago. There are mounds in England. There are mounds in Germany. There are mounds in Scandinavia. As you come across the ocean, there are mounds in the Americas, Canada. And most of the mounds now in the USA are in the eastern part, from Maine to Florida, and from the Atlantic to the Mississippi. Now there are a few other mounds still in the western states, but not as many as the ones in the eastern portion. And so the mounds, this is where the pyramids started, from mound building. And there are earthen mounds and there are stone mounds, and the stone mounds are the ones that turn into pyramids. And we have the first pyramid by Imhotep was the step pyramid, and then later on, the hundreds of years later, the smooth sided pyramid comes. Constructions and architecture were taken with the black folks who proliferated all over the planet, from the equator all the way to Alaska. Did you know that the Eskimos are brown skin?
Eskimos. No, I did not know that.
Short and tannish brown skin, light brown skin. Yeah. So we were the first, and it's like we might be the last.
You know, and we talked about him earlier, Professor Kaba Hiawatha Kamene. The first show that he and I did when he first appeared on my show, which now I think is the largest view show, I think it's over almost 200,000 views on that show alone. It was about how Africans turn white. Because that's one of the biggest things. It's like, well, where do white people come from? How did this happen? Many people say, why did this happen? That's for another show. But, you know, we have the ability, and we're talking about the African female, has the ability to create all ethnicities and all other races. And that is a hard pill to swallow for some, even for some of us, because there are so many variables of skin tone and skin shade and skin color. Now, here's the other piece to this, that if you could help us fill in the blank. So we understand and we've heard, okay, they came from the Ice Age. They got caught in the last worm glaciation of this Ice Age, and these Africans lost over hundreds of thousands of years, lost their skin pigmentation, lost their phenotype, their original African phenotype, due to the climactic events over history, over time, being subjected to 100, 200 below zero weather, never having the sunshine, having to be able to have to grow their crops 3 months out of the year so that they could eat for the remainder of the year, and becoming, in a sense, barbaric because they had to contain and control the resources so much that it created a nervous system. And this is Dr. Edwin Nichols' work that we've had on the show, axiologist and philosopher, 50-year veteran, talks about how, as a result of this environment that was constantly trying to kill you, that this is the nature of how they became objective and individualistic and wanted to conquer and divide everything. So in your research, and we'll get to the Americans, the Africans in America, being first in America, but in your work, what have I just shared with you is fact, misnomer, or needs more research or to fill in the blanks?
Not much. The only thing I can do with what you just said is tweak a little bit. And that is to be precise, the first people Homo sapiens, modern man and women, went up into the Western Europe approximately 45,000 years ago. And they were there for a few thousand years and did what they were doing all over, building things. But at one point, a storm came. And the storm didn't last a few hours or a few days. It lasted for a few years. And we're talking about a total change in climate that went from maybe 50, 60 degrees, 70 degrees to minus 10 below, as you were talking about, overnight. And the people who were there had to run and find shelter right away. So if their dwellings hadn't blown away, they would have to go to some place that was already available for them, and so they went to caves. And slowly but surely, they lost their pigmentation because there was very little sun, as you said before. And in most cases, there was not any fish available, which gives you vitamin D, which helps you hold on to your color. So this is what happened after a few tens of years, and they slowly but surely lost their color. Now, I remember a fella that I went to school with. He had done a total roundabout change from a life of crime, where he did a couple years in jail, to being a phenomenal student. And he was put in solitary confinement for a couple weeks, or maybe it was a couple months. He was a very dark fellow, dark complected. And when he came out of the solitary confinement cell, he had not changed color, but he had gotten significantly lighter. So this sun that we have that gives life to the whole universe and to our planet and to our plants and to us, there are many mystical things that happen that we still don't understand. Mm. That is the things that happen. We lost our color. No such thing as race. Mm-hmm. This thing is race. It's the human race. It comes in all shapes, sizes, and colors. And the sooner we get over that, the better our lives will be. So that's about the real the nutshell.
So, so Donald Trump comes from us. Hey, man, let's just, if we're gonna keep it real up in here, if we're gonna keep it 100. You know, we looking at the entire race. They came from us. They're derivatives. I think, Professor, I'm being facetious about Trump, but not really. But yeah. Professor Kappa says they are mutations of a mutation. Now, this is really fascinating to me because, okay, white folks, Europeans, and white is the label. Racial label as is black is a racial label and construct. But Eurasians were originally Africans. So you know, we're trying to take the mythology out of this and put the science in it.
Yes.
Because if they originally were Africans, that means that they were us, so they knew how to farm, they knew how to live, they knew how to, they were part of civilization, they were traveling. So this makes sense. They didn't just pop up like, you know, you put a Pop-Tart in and wait a few minutes and then poof, you got toast. This was an evolutionary process of the African turning into a Eurasian. So yeah. In a sense, you have, as a result, you come from an environment that loves you. Sun shining bright, plenty of food, plenty of fish, plenty of water, everything you need, absolute nirvana. And then you get stuck in an environment for thousands of years. How many years was the Ice Age? Was this going on? How many?
Started around 115,000 years ago and ended around 7,000 to 8,000 years ago. And in between, there were some interstitials that got a little warmer, and then it would come back with ferocity. So it was around at least 100,000 years old.
Okay. Okay. Whew. All right. So here you are, you know, living civilization, procreating, creating new generations, creating new families. And over a period of time, you have to learn how to survive in this hostile environment. And we, from Dr. Nichols' work, again, we know that the way the nervous system is programmed from the environment and also from the climate. So if you if something is trying to constantly kill you, that creates a certain nervous system, a certain reaction, a certain way of thinking, where you become individualistic, you become object-oriented, not relational, which is who we originally are. We're relational people, family people. But when you are trying to eat and there's no food, perhaps that's where cannibalism was born, if you will, because we hear stories about people eating their children and their young when there was no food around. Don't know if that is fact or fiction. You can elaborate on that. But what I'm trying to get to, Doc, is
Daniel Boone had to do that.
Say again?
Daniel Boone had to do that when he was crossing the mountains in West Virginia into the wilderness. They got caught in a storm. And they were bogged down, and they lost their food. And his people around him, a few of them, started doing the cannibalistic thing.
So there's a confirmation.
Yeah,
there's a confirmation. So the scary thing is that when we look at a Eurasian, we're looking one at our children, and we're looking also at, in a sense, the worst manifestation of ourselves, because they're part of that evolution that environment tried to kill them, and they had to create a shelter and a mindset of survival that was a hyper survival technique and skills and mindset and mentality. So walk us through this then, Doc. How did, because there's a whole bunch of malarkey about the Bering Strait and how they came over the mountains and down the hills and all of that, which is impossible. Walk us through the Bering Strait and how these lost Africans that got lost in time came out and then started populating and mixing with the indigenous Africans that were already here.
Right. Well, the Clovis story, as we're told, you know, that Clovis started around 9,400 years ago. Sorry, but it just didn't happen. They looked unsuccessfully for clues and whatnot. They came up with some arrowheads, and they found out that the arrowheads and some of the tools that were in Clovis, and this is Clovis, New Mexico.
Okay.
They found that they had a life before Clovis in the eastern United States and southern. So they pushed that away. The next thing they do, they say, well, they came across the ice and across the Bering Straits and blah, blah, blah. Excuse me. Right.
Come on with it, Doc. Come on with it.
It's kind of hard to cross a glacier that's 1 to 2 miles high. And that's what happened during 115,000 years of snow and ice. It does not happen. So because they finally did some studies and some diggings and whatnot, there they saw that, well, maybe they came from another way. So they had this other island hopping, or not island hopping, really. It was a coastal invasion of the Western Hemisphere, and that was to go along the coast from China all the way up to Russia and somehow leap across the Bering Straits, which was not a part of land but was ice, and then they get into the coastal plain of Alaska and then down to California. Now, if you have ever seen, and most people have seen this commercial, where they have a cruise line that goes up into Alaska during the winter time, mm-hmm. and you can see that right. I know you've seen it too. I see you shaking your head.
Yeah, absolutely. I know where you're going. Yeah,
there's no land there. There is ice, and some of the pieces of ice are falling off into the water and makes waves. You see, so how did they get around all that ice? No, that didn't happen. There's no evidence to prove that. That's how I can say it did not happen. Then they say, well, maybe they came from Australia. Australia, which is 9,600 miles away from the western part of the Americas, wow. where from Africa, it's only 1,500 miles away. So, you know, we have them coming with all of these different theories coming from anywhere, but from Africa, and it's never discussed.
Fascinating. Thank you for breaking that down for us. Yes, this is what we need. This is filling in the blanks. Okay. Now, let's get to the first Americans are Africans, and I'm going to go as far as to say, because I'm this, your work, which is so great, changes my language. It doesn't just put things in context, but you have to take responsibility for your language, and so therefore I have to say that the first Americans had to be African, because there's no other explanation. So I can't say it without having a level of conviction behind it, because again, first means first. We populated the entire planet. We have our footprint and our flag on every continent, and that's starting with the mounds and the pyramids, going to the pyramids everywhere. We know how the Eurasian came about. They came about through us. They got stuck in the ice. So wouldn't it make sense? So let's just, you know, do some American history work here, ladies and gentlemen, and common sense. How in the heck could a Native American be a Native American? It's not possible. There had to be something that morphed them into becoming a Native American. And guess what, Doc? You're going to tell us how. Because you are the one who told me that there was a doctor who did a test. I think he was from Nigeria. I don't remember his name. You can fill in the blank on that. But there was a natural current that goes from Africa to the Americas, and it took him only, made a boat, took him 52 days.
Yes.
To get from the continent of Africa to America, 52 days. Now, you also write about that we were the ones, of course, it makes sense because we're the ones that do everything. We created sailing. We built the first ships, and not like some little grass, you know, thing that they show on the History Channel, that BS. But actual ships. Walk us through that history and if you will, our original movie coming to America.
Okay. Well, of course, the first try at seamanship would have to be of someone around the Nile River, which is one of the oldest, the oldest navigated river in the world. You had to have come on one side of the Nile River and say, boy, it would like nice to be over there, and they would see a few pieces of straw or a piece of wood just coming down Nile River and says, wait a minute. If I jumped in that Nile River and jumped on that that log, maybe I can make it to the other side. And the ones who made it to the other side without being eaten by the alligators and crocodiles, they said, okay, we had a good idea, but it's not too good. It's not really good.
Yeah, it's not perfected yet.
Not yet. Yeah. I don't know where Junior.
We lost Jumbo and Subo over there, but, you know, so we might need to refine this a little bit.
So what they did was they took a log and they hewed out the inside of it. And what they have was dug out a canoe. So you go through the dugout canoe phase, and you say, well, I want to get upstream now. How do I row upstream? Because the Nile River is a serious river, especially in rain season. You cannot go upstream. It was somebody was standing up one day and had a big shirt on, and the shirt got caught on someone else, and the wind was blowing. They couldn't separate, and they saw that it was moving the ship a little bit. Of course, this is fictitious, but something happened to
– Something happened where they figured it out.
Exactly, to do that. So, yes, the first everything, of course, was in Africa. That's where the first civilizations developed and the first people. So if the first people had been white, then we would have no problem in saying, you know, let them have it. They're the first people. Or if they had been Chinese, they're the first people. But it just didn't happen that way. It was the black folks who were here first. And I'm not excusing that or making an excuse for it, okay? I am proud of what we have done over the millennia, the tens of thousands of years. So. It's been a real journey. But now to get back to the boat going across the first expedition going across from Africa to the Americas, a Nigerian doctor put together a little experiment, and he had a dugout canoe that had no sail, no rudder, no motor, and no paddle, and he put it in the ocean current that goes from the Ghana area, about a half mile or a mile off of Ghana, and it goes over north, northwest, over right past South America into the Bahamas area. And if you curve to the right a little bit, it'll take you up to Florida and into the continental United States. And he, of course. People say, well, that's impossible. Well, he had a feeder ship, which was a ship that would hand him down his food and his water and anything else he needed, metal equipment, anything he needed, but it never touched. So he made it all the way across there in only 52 days. Now, this is without a paddle or even a sail. So if you put a paddle or a sail on that, you're gonna knock over maybe a third of that, and so you wouldn't have but maybe a month or so.
So you're just coming back and forth. This is a vacation trip for you.
There you go.
I mean, honestly, that's just like, you know, that's like almost going upstream, upriver. I mean, that's nothing.
Because it curves around. As that stream, the winds and the waves take you over to the Americas, it circles back around up to the north and then over into the England area, and then goes down to Africa and starts over again. And there's another current like that over in the Pacific. It does the same thing, only now it goes counterclockwise, of course.
Yeah. Wow. This is great. All right. Now, you know, this is fantastic. We've got more. Don't go nowhere. This e-course. You dig deep. You go deep into it in this 5-day e-course, and you're generous enough to give away the introduction of the new book. Before we take on how the Africans turn into Native Americans, talk to me about what's the difference between the first edition of the book and the current edition, the new edition that's coming out.
Well, I wrote a piece up on that. Okay, and it says, why buy this new book? It's almost double the size, 14 more photos, much more new research, and it has almost 1,000 different footnotes. So the footnotes alone can fill up a small library. Because what a footnote is for those youngsters who don't know what a footnote is you document and you back up your information by a book. So you take the the information from who the author is and how old, when it was published, et cetera, et cetera. And you have, you go and find that book. Well, this, we're talking about 1,000 different entries. So that's a,
wow.
In itself worth some money, but we have gone into South America on this plane, and also we go into different things such as the Native American. One of the biggest things that we're going to do a piece, I understand, on that is that a lot of the most Native Americans, if not all, not all, of course, because that's a term you should never use, but most Native Americans say that when they're asked where did the Native Americans come from, it says, oh, we've always been here. And unfortunately, that is not true. It doesn't, it's not backed up by science. If you dig in North, Central, and South America, right, they have never found any bones of any archaic humans. None of Australopithecus, Homo habilis, forensis, or even Neanderthal. They've only found modern man, which are Homo sapiens. So this string of
has to be African.
Yeah, exactly. Had to evolve into what we are today. Mm-hmm. Now, if there are no people who are the archaic people, how can they evolve?
Right.
So they were here. They have not always been here. And they are our people. And the Indians say, well, we're the Indians. Blah, blah, blah. So let me tell you something. Okay? And this is it. The first Africans come over when my book, 2011, the information, Nadine Guidon, who is another French anthropologist, she found that there was a cave, a series of caves in Brazil at Cerro de Capoeira Park. Mm. And they found some hearths and whatnot. There were 100,000 years old, hearths being fires that the people mm-hmm. were some stone tools. Now, since then, 15, 20 years later, they dug a little further down, and now they have found that it goes back to 100,000 years, not the 51,000 that she first came up with.
Holy cow, wow.
However, a couple months ago, they came out with another date for people in other Americas, and they're talking about some signs of people stripping the bones of mammoths, which are the elephants, in Southern California, and they have put a label of 300,000 years on that. And as the years go past, as they do other diggings, I guarantee you it'll go even further back. So
this is amazing.
Exactly. So
this is amazing.
These people have been here for 100,000 years. Now cultures change. Years with generations. But we're talking about a thousand generations going from 1 year to 130,000 years. So slowly these cultures change from Africans into the Native Americans. And I have pictures of Africans who've never even heard, I won't say never heard, but who've never been to the United States or any place over here, whose tradition is wearing feathers in their hair. The skirts. How do you possibly have Native Americans in an Arizona dance, a special dance, a medicine men do, who are wearing skirts as they dance? Why is that? Because the Egyptians and the people of that nature came over and influenced some of the ones who were doing something else, and they started wearing skirts. Because that's what the Egyptians were. They wore skirts. It was hot. You know, a man will get suffocated if he wears underwear in 110, 115 degrees. You know, his lower extremities will suffocate.
I can be facetious and say, you know, in Sacramento today it's 113 degrees. Unfortunately, I'm not wearing a skirt. But I could, you know, I could just go to my ancient Egyptian roots, you know, and I could probably swag that. But I'm not going to do that to the people right now. I don't want nobody to see me that way. But you're saying, though, here's the thing. Everything you're saying is, and I know for a fact, because I know I'm going to get the comments, and I can almost read the comments and pre-read them, and that's going to be, oh, my God, he is speaking directly to me. oh my God, this makes so much sense. Oh my, OMG, 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 because doesn't this make sense? Now, because before, when you allow someone who was never originally at or invited to the party to tell the story of the party, they are inevitably going to get it wrong, and they're going to make themselves the masters of ceremony and tell the story so that it makes them look wonderful and great and the creator of civilization. The reason that you are confused is because you're listening to your child tell you about your history, and it is your history and your job and duty to be the parent to go and find this information so that when that child comes to you telling you, here's who you are, what you are, you say, no, 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 no. Let me tell you who you are, where you come from, and how you got here. That is your responsibility, our responsibility as parents of this planet. Walk us through you in this e-course that you produced, Doc, which I've been absorbing like water. There's a great story in there about the Vikings. It cracked me up because, you know, we all think the Vikings are, you know, just badasses, you know, these European barbaric badasses.
I know where you're going.
Yeah, yeah. So no, I want you to tell the story. So you know, a lot of these Eurasians kind of smell themselves a little bit. So we're just going to take it down a little notch. Tell the story about the Vikings and what happened when they met these little short black folk up there on the north side. Talk to us about that.
Have no doubt the Vikings with some serious warriors, and they took over Western Europe.
Yep.
All the way from Scandinavia all the way down to France, they took over. They never left the battle, including over in Europe, over in England. But they made a little trip from Scandinavia to Iceland, and then from Iceland to Canada. Now, when they got to Canada, they saw something that they had heard about from their great-grandparents, mm-hmm. but they had never seen. And that was little short fellows, 3.5, 4.5 feet. And they looked at them, I'm sure, for the first time and said, oh, boy, this is going to be a phenomenal show we're going to have. And what they did was for maybe the first couple of weeks or maybe a couple of months, whatnot, they traded with each other. They talked, they laughed, they had a good time. But sooner or later, that Viking came out of them. And it's, you know, they had that warrior spirit. And they started having little disputes, and then it created a battle and then a war. And after around 5 or 6 or 7 years, the wars got so bad they never won a skirmish. They said, I think it's time to get out of here. So they left. They left. And they did not come back. No Europeans came back for 1,000 years.
Wow. 1,000 years.
Maybe it was 100 years. One of those. Okay. Right, I can't remember exactly the term. But it was a long time. No, it wasn't 1,000. About 100. But it was the next people to come over are Leif Erikson and then Columbus and Soto and those type people.
Okay, that's fantastic. All right, so now we're on the home stretch here, Doc, because this is such good stuff here. When we were talking, on the phone the first time, you and I both refer to Columbus as punk ass Columbus. We don't even give him any respect or props whatsoever, and what was great about our conversation about Columbus, or what was enlightening for me about the conversation about Columbus, was you said he never stepped foot on American shores. Now, I'm just thinking about growing up and the story of Columbus, Thanksgiving, you know, the Native Americans, the Indians, And there are so many, you know, so a lot of people are just uncovering the truth or the lie, if you will, about Columbus. And that's a big deal. Now we have just uncovered the lie about the Native Americans. We have to understand the Eurasian, basically, it's like waking up in the Matrix or from the Matrix. Yes. That's what it's analogous to me is. It's like, well, what the hell is real? Because none of it is, because it's all stolen, it's all fabricated, it's all the Americas is based upon a system and series of lies. All right, so now let's talk about, unpack Columbus for us, and his, I think it was his brother. Walk us through that, and then we'll talk about, you'll help us understand what migration occurred from the, you know, with the Mongolians and the indigenous Africans here, and how the Native Americans became, how the Africans became Native Americans as a result of that. Start off, though, talk to us about Columbus.
Yes, well, Columbus...
Columbus, as we would say.
Columbus wanted to make a name for himself, and he promised the queen that he could, if she built ships for him, he could do real well, because he had heard from some of the scouts or whatever that there were gold mines, or just gold, over in the next place they were going in, which what they really thought he was going to India. Mm. So when he got out in the ocean and he finally comes to land, he sees dark people with long hair, Native Americans. Mm. And he thought he was in India. He did not know that he was not India. He never set foot on the continental United States. This is what the white textbooks say.
Wow.
He never set foot. He stepped foot in Haiti, San Domingo, and possibly Cuba and a couple other islands, but he never reached the mainland. His brother, however, did. Now, after when he did the make landfall, the people that he met were phenomenally nice, friendly people. They welcomed them. They fed them. They built shelters for them. They did a lot of different things for them, and it was like it was nothing they wouldn't do for them.
Wow.
Okay. But Columbus went back, and he told the Queen a couple things, and obviously someone had found a little, or they gave Columbus's crew some gifts, and maybe was a piece of gold or something in there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, brothers love gold.
We love gold. That's right. We bling bling. Back then,
no doubt, and the people in Western Africa used to color their tips of their spears with gold. So there was nothing to them because it was all around. So when the queen heard about that, she went crazy. Get on back over there. So when he came over, this time he came over as a conqueror, and the same people who had shown him gracious hospitality, he herded them into ships, killed many of them, and took a good number of them out back. And that was the horrible story about Columbus.
So we're again. I forgot who I had on the show, and it might have been, I don't know if it was Dr. Nichols. It might have been Kaba. I refer to Columbus and the Eurasians and. I refer to them as Christian terrorists because that's what terrorists do. That act is an act of terror. I am not afraid of ISIS because we're not afraid of this new version of terrorism, because by default of us being labeled and have morphed into what we now call ourselves as African American, we're forged from terrorism. We are forged from terrorism. So this is the history that they don't want little Becky to know about, right? Because little Becky is, you know, nice little cute blonde blue-eyed girl in school, and America is great and wonderful, and this is why we go into the military and why we go into law enforcement to protect American values. And this is the real deal of what America looks like. This is my goal. This is my job. This is my truth, to uncover the truth and unpack it, but not from anger, not from emotion, and not from hyperbole, but from evidence and fact and science. So this is why this conversation is so pivotal for me, and I'm sure, looking at the numbers of the people who are watching live, for you as well out there. So let's talk about now how the Native American evolved into the Native American from the African. Walk us through that through that history.
Okay, as I said before, when you're in a group, and the group is in a place or travels around, they slowly change. Which mm-hmm. The environment changes, their diet changes, they make strides, and new things happen, and new things going on. And after 130,000 years, you have a total change in the people who were there before. You know, you send a kid away to camp for 2 months in the summer. He comes back a little different after a couple weeks in camp. So mm-hmm. We're talking about not a couple weeks, not a couple centuries, not a couple millennia, but we're talking about 100 to 130,000 years where these people are over there by themselves, and they slowly, but in a long period of time, change. And it's amazing that they didn't change more than that. But they do change. And like I said before, you can see Africans today who've never been to the United States wearing feathers and different skirts when they do their dances. And there's a lot of other things that go in that we just don't have time to talk about now.
Sure. But, is it true that the Mongolians came and commingled, if you will, with the Native Africans, and that also was part of the evolution and the phenotypal change? Is that accurate?
Oh, absolutely. They did come across the Bering Straits, but far after the 1 to 2 mile icebergs melt. Okay, when there were no icebergs, and we're talking about the Asians themselves in their most sacred work, the Wallan Ola, which white folks have called the Red Record.
Mm-hmm.
All right. What they say is they are the ones saying this, that they first came over in 2600 BC. Mm. That's when they came over. And when they come over, they meet black folks who have been there for 100 or more thousand years, who are not only farming gigantic farms and jungles of fruit trees, but they see them doing other things that are modern things, like building homes a different way, and building mounds, and then building pyramids, if you will. And they built pyramids, Africans built pyramids, and we didn't cover this, in every continent in the world. And people say, oh, wait a minute, Doc. There's nothing in Alaska, I mean, in the north or the far south in Antarctica. And Google pyramids in Antarctica. Now, when that first came up, there were 5 pictures of different pyramids it looked like they were mountains at first, but then they took the pictures of when the snow was halfway down, you could clearly see halfway to the base that there were stone structures, pyramids.
My God. Right?
They've taken all pictures down. 4 are down. I think there's only 1 picture left that they left up. And of course they are going after that, saying, oh no, it was not true, blah blah blah.
Wow.
No. Stop it.
Just stop it. So you know, here's another rub, and that is there a good story about white folk? I mean, just can we find, because this is what we're also up against when we're dealing with this systemic racism and this sick mindset called racism, this psychopathy, this psychopathic behavior that came as a result of having to function in a society in the Ice Age. You develop a pathological, psychopathic personality. Is there a good story? You know, and I know you're not an evolutionist in a sense. You're a futurist and a scholar and a scientist, but this is a hard pill for whites to swallow, because this is hard science. This is not fictional. No. This is just hard science. And every human being wants to feel good about themselves. That's what cognitive dissonance is, right? When we look at Dr. Joy DeGruy's work, Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome, cognitive dissonance. It's like, okay, I am abusing these people, but I don't feel right about it. So I have to do something in my mind to justify dehumanizing, vilifying, minimizing these people, and in order to survive and not go crazy. But in the sense of not going crazy, I'm already crazy. I've already lost my mind, and I'm psychopathic because I am now trying to justify the damnation of another human being, a population of people. Dr. Frances Cress Welsing talks about reaction formation in the beginning of her book. What is reaction formation? It's when you see something that you want to be, do, and have so greatly, so badly that you will never, ever have it. You'll never be able to produce melanated children or offspring. You will never be melanated. You were probably rejected when you came out of that cave by all the Africans. You didn't look like the entire population. So yeah, you were probably treated not well. So that had another psychological bearing on you. So reaction formation says that I am going to hate you, vilify you, minimize you, and make you the problem, and reverse psychology. You are the problem on the planet, even though I'm the minority of the planet. So we're beginning to see the psychological, philosophical, physiological profile, truly, of the Eurasian in historical context versus just what happened here in America in slavery. Is there a good point? Is there a love story here somewhere, Doc? It doesn't look like there is.
With all the interracial marriage, how can you say that? Oh, there's a love story going on, and there's a hate story. There are white folks fighting white folks, black folks fighting black folks. There are good white folks and there are bad black folks. White folks are good white black folks, and there are notorious black folks. I mean, this whole race
thing is just about humanity. It's really about humans being human.
Yes, yes.
And you know, I don't know if Sister Imuna Yisrael is out there. We haven't had her on the show recently, but Sister Imuna, I'm giving you a shout out and raising you up high, because you were one of the first to come on my show to talk about we're human, and the same things that we have blamed white folks for doing, we do too, and had to, because if we were first, they weren't all, you know, just peachy and rosy Africans and what have you, running around, you know, singing Kumbaya, whatever the hell they were singing at the time. So these personality traits are coming also, you know, everybody is born with the same personality and traits. It's the environment that shapes how those personality and traits manifest themselves in your environment. So that's a hard pill to swallow for us. Because, you know, we want to justify this. These people are absolutely scum of the earth. They're this and they're that. And yeah, you're right. We're not taking that away. But we're also saying, let's be accountable as adults, because we're understanding they're our children. Be the parent and recognize, hey, you've done or thought some stuff too. You just haven't acted on it because you haven't been in an environment where you've had to do that. Now that also is what Frances Cress Welsing talks about, is one of their biggest fears, because you tend to project onto others what you think about yourself. that biggest fear is the fear of retribution, the fear of revenge, the fear of a hostile takeover. It's the fear of everything that they've done. It's a legitimate fear. Now, some would say, we're not about that. We just want our own proximity and to be able to rebuild ourselves, heal ourselves, relieve ourselves of our post-traumatic slave syndrome, our PTSS, relieve ourselves of the microaggressions, relieve ourselves of the racial battle fatigue. But guess what? Y'all won't leave us alone. And we're still under this institution that was born under white supremacy or institutionalized racism. The question then becomes, what now? Sound like Kevin Hart up here. What now? What does this work do, Dr. Imhotep, to liberate us? Because we're going through another evolution. Let's look at ourselves 100,000 years from now. What will the African American in this country, what will the African in this country look like 100,000 years from now? How can we use this work to push the curve, shorten the curve, or speed the curve up for our liberation?
What we have to do, and this is what I am trying to do, is to let us know about our history. Because that is the thing that helped me when I was younger. I did not know what I know today, obviously. I had no idea about our history. But if black folks, please, when you learn about your ancient history, not back in the 50s or the 40s, what I'm talking about back in the Egyptian times and before, which is my field, the Nubians and the Kushites and all these people who ran the world before there were any other so-called races of brothers and sisters. So when you learn and learn your history and have your historic esteem, you absolutely roll right into a good self-esteem. Because you know your race and people around and do it. So if they did it, then we can do it. And if we did it once, we can do it again. But we're not talking about taking over. This is garbage. I'm talking about living in a peaceful world, coexisting, and doing what we need to do, and that is to be happy, holy, healthy, and friendly.
The principles of my art.
Exactly. Exactly. And that is what we all need to learn and relearn. And black folks, I'm sorry, my brothers and sisters, but we were beaten down and we were crushed and we were not, did not let us sometimes to go to school, even generations, okay? So we have lost, many of us have lost our history and don't know very much about us. We have the African-American history, but there are no places in this country that are teaching a Ph.D. or a master's level in ancient African history.
You're the first.
I was the first. I developed that with my dissertation team.
Wow. It's like I'm sitting here. I'm feeling like Phil Donahue, man, because I'm like, I 20 years from now, I'm going to look back and be like, that's history right there. Brother who had the first PhD in this, that's insane to me. I am so humbled, honored. You know, thank you so much thank you, Brother Professor Kaba, for the introduction. I must be doing something right because I keep attracting these most brilliant minds in the world that are corroborating and uncovering, rediscovering our history, and giving truth to it, not hyperbole, not being the angry black woman, the angry black man, but just calm, sensible science that we all feel, but it's nice when there's a confirmation and a context that we and language that we can put this finally into. Running this down, are there any original, quote unquote, Native Americans or Africans here?
Oh, yes. You know, this is a phenomenal story. I am the man who wrote about the first Americans to be Africans. And even I, until a couple years after I wrote my book, did not know that there were still some remnants of the first Americans.
Really?
Yes. And wow. I'm talking about people who claim they have not intermingled with not only whites or Asians, but not even the so-called American Negro, how they marry within.
Really?
Okay? Sure. Chief Warhorse. Chief Elwin Warhorse in down in Louisiana. I was in speaking at a church and about 3 or 4 years ago in Atlanta. And the person who came in, I would say like the praise team who gets everyone hyped up, was this wonderful lady. She was dressed like an Indian, but she looked African. It's like she looks now with her beautiful looks. And she did a speech that just blew people away. And my mouth was open as much as anyone out in the audience, but I did not know what she taught that evening. So we, of course, got together after that. And of course, she said she was coming up to speak to Congress.
Wow.
And I said, well, hey, I'm of 95. I'm right along the way. Stop by. So, you know, stop by and have lunch and then recover your sleep and going back to D.C. So they stopped by with five of them. And instead of staying for lunch, they stayed for 3 days.
Wow.
We had phenomenal discussions, phenomenal. And I said, wait a minute, I got to come down and see. So 2 months later, I went down to Louisiana. And I saw what she was talking about. And I saw that, yes, they are indeed there. And Slidell, all over the southern eastern parts of the United States. She said, I said, how many do you have black Indians in this area? She said, about 24,000. I said, 24,000? She says, yeah. I said, no. I said, how many are have married between themselves and did not go out with marry others? They stay within their tribes. Or not. She said, about half. I said, 12,000 unmixed, man. She says, yeah. She says, but there's more in southern Mississippi, southern Alabama, southern Georgia, and down the Everglades. I said, oh, in the Everglades? And I said, what are you talking about down there? She said, I said, the Indians down there? She says, yes, those are our Indians. I won't even say the name. Those are our people down in Everglades. So she taught me, she gave me a tutorial on these different things. And I always go back to hear more because she's fun. She can talk for 2 hours, won't repeat herself, and will keep your attention. Straight up. She's a brilliant.
Original Africans.
Yeah.
You will, pure bloods.
Same bloodline.
Pure bloodline, indigenous to this, that are still here.
Still alive. And they have been, well, not just marginalized, but the history has been erased. And here's a
case. Yeah, you're right. Marginalized means that there's erased. Some talk about them.
Erased.
They were erased. I am hearing of this for the first time.
Erased. You have not heard about the discovery they made in downtown New Orleans, have you? No one has outside of New Orleans. No one has. They shut this down like a five-story fire. They shut it down. What happened was a fellow was digging a, and this is in downtown New Orleans. He was in his house. He had someone come out and was digging a backyard pool. And they knocked into something that was really hard. And he said, well, I'll go over a few more feet. And same digging there. Hard there, and he goes up to third place. Hard. He says, wait a minute. They uncovered it, and it was an old graveyard going back to the 1700s. Okay? And they were black Indians and freedmen. It's a black graveyard. And what did they do when they took out that casket, okay, which is a cypress casket, and they opened it up, and they saw people dressed with phenomenal, nice clothes on, upper class, some others were regular people, and some of them were Native Americans. And right away, they put up a 6-foot wall all the way around so that you couldn't look through it, you couldn't look over it. They did a few studies for a few days, and they covered it all back up. And what happened? The story never left New Orleans.
But my brother, Dr. David Imhotep, found it, damn it. That's what you do.
No doubt.
That's who you are. Man, if it needs to be found out, my brother's going to find it out. Really? New Orleans? How long ago was this?
4 or 5 months. 6 months, maybe.
Stop. Are you serious right now?
Maybe 3/4 of a year, but not even a year ago.
Oh, my God. So, see, this is so powerfully important that, yes, history has been fabricated. History has been marginalized. History has been erased. But it's still happening. We keep making the mistake of looking back and say, okay, well, they did this and did that, but now things are different. No, it isn't. The information, ladies and gentlemen, that all of these historians are digging up. The reason they don't want us to know, particularly in school, what ancient Egypt and who we are, is because it would literally, the rest of the world would force America to change. The rest of the world would force America to change and say, wait a minute, you guys got to make a change here, because this now becomes undeniable. And so the goal is to do what Dr. Joy DeGruy tells us to do, and that is to create a preponderance of overwhelming evidence by remaining calm and doing your research, scientific, finding these laureates, finding the David Imhoteps, finding the Dr. Joys, the Professor Cabas, the Edwin Nichols, researching and reading so that you can pass this on to the next generation. I just did a radio show with a demographer, who basically a demographer is someone who counts people and is a futurist and can predict pretty much about 80% accuracy all the trends that's going to happen in America and the world. And the number of millennials or Generation Ys is 86 million. There's 86 million of you out there that, and remember, if you watched the first show I did with Dr. Edwin Nichols, he says it would only take one generation to in epigenetics and genetic memory to completely flip this thing around. One generation. Well, there's 86 million Generation Ys or millennials coming out of the homes, the largest generation since the boomers, getting ready to change the absolute interface of this country. In the next 20 years, America will be unrecognizable. Other countries around the world will be unrecognizable because of the sheer numbers of us, of white folks too. I mean, everybody, you know. But there's a huge number, a population that can literally shut this down and change the world, which they will. And it's going to be led by women. That is the numbers. That's what the numbers are showing us, the Census Bureau, the Homeland Security numbers, all of that, Pews, everything that we study. So that being said, Doc, what do we need to do now that we understand this? And I want to get to Bimini too, because and the e-course, because one of the things I know that you're going to start doing is taking people on tours to show them where our ancient original African history is here in America, because most of us, we always go to Egypt and go to various different places around the world to do that. But, you know, hey, let's go somewhere here and say, hey, here's evidence of the first Africans on this continent. But before we get into that, Doc, as we wind down, let's talk about what do we need? What obviously reading your book, of course, and maybe even creating a study group for this book and for this work, but what can we begin doing with our children, for our children, to begin leaking this information and getting it out into the masses? What are some of your thoughts on that?
Well, one of the things that just jumped into my mind was, one of the things that we have to do is to watch the movie Hidden Figures and to let the black folks know, and especially the sisters know, that they can do what those sisters in that movie did. I got to tell you,
I never clapped on my own damn show before. This is the first time I done clapped on my show. Thank you for that. That's absolutely wonderful.
I've done some boxing. I got through college on a football scholarship, and I'm a so-called manly man, but I had tears in my eyes twice during that show. I had tears in my eyes, joy. Just overcome almost with emotion to see what sisters did at that time and how it has been, what, erased and shut up for all of those years. There are sisters out there now who are doing the same things, but they're not recognized. Mm. So that's what I think one of the things we have to do is to support our sisters and give them whatever they need to do what supposedly a man has been just given the right to do. So I think that's the major ways. And then from there, at the same time, as you say, educate our children with their history.
Yes, yes. Oh, this is great. This is fantastic. Thank you. We did a movie review on Hidden Figures with Professor Kaba, Sister Emuna Yisrael, and I believe Minister Imhotep Al-Kabulan. So Al-Kabulan, excuse me. So, you know, I'll connect those shows with this one. And yes, you're going to be on shows with them too, so we can, because this is an ongoing conversation to unpack this level of history. All right, Bimini Row, aka the Bimini Breakwater and Pier, and this is one of the last days of the course, actually, that people can go in the link below and subscribe to. It's free, and you're going to get a free chapter of the new book, the updated version, the second edition. The first Americans were Africans. But what is the significance of Bimini Road, and where is it?
The Bimini Road is right off Bimini. It's a mile offshore. There was once in the Bahamas right now, the islands that you see in the Bahamas right now, back before the last ice age melt in the cataclysm that went on, the mountains that the islands we see now were once mountaintops of a very large island.
Mm.
Okay. And they, of course, it went out this island went towards the east a mile farther than it is today. In other words, it's flooded. And we have the Bimini Road, which is not a road. What it looked like a road from a boat, because there's a pier that has a fork, you know, like this, and it has a slot right here where boats can come in and unload on both sides. Mm. I mean, well, these people were brilliant. Long, long, long.
We built piers, ships. It was civilization. Civilization is civilization.
And this happened. This happened, obviously, since it's under 30 feet of water. Okay. There was not, we should say, well, what do someone build a submarine base? Come on. Come on. This is under 30 feet of water, which means this civilization had technology before the last ice age ended and flooded the planet.
Wow.
Okay? And they have shown that it was between 200 and 300 foot level of ice that melted into the water and brought up the waters 200 to 250, 300 feet high. And so they had this breakwater and pier, not just a pier, but a breakwater. What a breakwater does is, see, if you come into a shore and you park your boat and you try to unload, it's going to be going up and down with ebb and flow of the waves. So what these brilliant guys did was they created an artificial harbor. How do you do that? Out 50 yards away into the ocean, you put up a wall.
Mm. The
wall comes just a few feet above the ocean, and the waves break on this barrier, thus calling it a breakwater. And between those breakwaters and the shore, you have a calm stretch of artificial harbor where the people can come in and park their boats, and they can unload the ships without going up and down. This was done before the last ice age ended. Okay? It was 600 yards long. The blocks to build it were as big as the pyramid blocks. Hear me now. It was not put together with cement, but the sheer size and craftsmanship of those blocks, like the pyramids, is what kept them together. So these are two possible invites to invite you to think about who built this, but we won't get into that now. So there are artifacts and different things such as obelisks and columns that are all are different places underneath the water. But you can see that it had also Egyptian anchors. You can see there's no doubt who built this thing. But we're talking about 600-yard long pier and breakwater. All right? So this is now a mile out. It's a place where you can skin dive or come over and look at it through a boat, and we're going to have tours of there, and we're going to have a glass bottom boat for those people who don't want it to jump over the water and skin dive and down and see the phenomenal things that are to be seen 1 mile off of Bimini in the Bahamas, 55 miles from Miami.
This book, this work that you have done, this show is what I call a bottle of shut the hell up. And what is a bottle of shut the hell up? A bottle of shut the hell up is when somebody comes to you and starts talking about all this pseudoscience, all this BS about white this and white power and all of this crap and all of this, and black folks is this, but let them watch this show and it's a bottle of shut the hell up. Because it's undeniable. Or give them the book. It's a book of shut the hell up. It's a preponderance of overwhelming evidence. This is absolutely amazing because, you know, I consider myself to be pretty good at doing research, but I am so, you know, it's one of those things when you get into that research, you're like, you know, the old saying, especially the older you get, the more you think you know, the more less you know, because there's so much more out there. But and I was just having this conversation this morning with Professor Kaba. It's a drug, man. I can't stop researching. I mean, Kaba's going through the same thing. You're going through the same thing. You got found some new stuff. Say, I got to put this in a new edition. Because we keep going to try to find the truth. And why? Liberation of our people.
Yes.
We love our people. It's liberation of our people, man. And only way you can liberate is through giving them their truth, giving them their history back. And by giving us our history back, we have our pride and our truth back. And that's what this work is about, man. And I'm blown away. Now, I wanted to ask about, I don't know if we have time, if you want to talk about the cowboys and the Anu people and those were the only two questions I did not ask you. Maybe we should, and the Twa and the Anu people and the cowboys. Did you want to talk about that briefly, or do you want to save that for the next show?
Sure, we can do that. I mean, there wasn't cowboys and Indians.
There's no such thing as cowboys and Indians?
No, I'm saying it wasn't cowboys and Indians. It was cowboys and black people.
Okay. See, and this is just good. See, again, it's that language change, man. We've got to change the language because it's so easy, right? Yeah. That repetition of, you know, unfortunately beating at us in our heads. This is what we need, Doc. Thank you. So it's cowboys and black people, or cowboys and Africans,
right?
Not Indians. Okay, got it. Now, who are the Anu and the Twa people?
They are some of the most incredible. This story is really phenomenal, the Anu and the Twa. They are the people who went all over the planet first and civilized it and built these phenomenal structures, these gigantic temples and these pyramids and these civilizations all over the planet. Okay. When did this happen? It happened before the flood, during the era, the epoch of Zeptepi, Zeptepi. Zeptepi. Okay. Now, who are these people, and who are their descendants? Their descendants are the diminutive Africans, better known as the horrible name that should not be told. But I'll have to say because people don't know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the so-called pygmies. They were and are 3.5 to 4 feet tall. And you will see them in my new book. I'll have two, three pictures of them, singly and a group of them in my new book.
Wow.
The First Americans were Africans Revisited, instead of the old book, 2011, The First Americans Were Africans, Document Evidence. So, this is all just a phenomenal thing. And these people are the ones, not only who went east and west, but they also went north, as I was saying, 40 to 45,000 years ago, up into Europe, and put civilizations there, and slowly got snowed in. So those are who the Aniwatoya, and they're still around. They're small people all over the planet still, but we don't know. They are, of course, in Africa. Mm-hmm. Of course, they, but you go into South India, you'll see short ones. You go into Asia, you'll see short, dark-skinned Asians. You go into South America, you will see shorter people there. All over the planet, there's still people who are shorter. And we're talking about 3.5 to 4.5 feet tall. Some of them are still of that height. Now,
wow.
The last thing I'll say about these people, these were the first people that were short. It's just like a dinosaur. They weren't 2 or 3 stories tall. They were lizards.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we started the same way. We started short stature, and slowly but surely we got taller.
Wow.
And that's the main thing. And we got to be different colors. This is why, to show you how long we've been on this planet, the black folks have the shortest people in the world, the diminutive Africans, up to the tallest people in the world, the so-called Watusis or people of that nature. We have the darkest people in the world, okay, around the equator, and also the lightest people in the world. You'll see our black albinos.
Mm-hmm.
We have black. They have the crispy, very, very curly hair, all right? And they have the white skin. So we have been on this planet so long, we have differentiated.
We have morphed into every other ethnicity.
Exactly.
There it is.
Wow.
Okay. Yeah, I know the people are like blown away. I'm looking at the numbers here, and I know everybody's like, oh, hell to the North. Philippe, you did this. You got David Imhotep on the show. What? Yeah.
Imhotep.
Yeah. It's like that. And in your book and in your work, I adore you. I just absolutely love you. You're my brother, and I'm going to do everything I can in my power to let the world know about you and about your work. That's my job. However long I got on this planet, same with Professor Kaba and many of the laureates that are on my that have appeared on my show. That's my lane. That's my thing. That's my dedication. That's what I've dedicated my life to. But you said something in the book, which I don't know if it was a book, an article, or maybe it was on a talk show that you were on. Because the myth of the Noah and the Ark and the flood. And you talked about that is not where that comes from is the melting, the huge melting of the glaciers. Can you walk us through that? Because that's tedious history for a lot of people. Can you shed some light on that as we close out?
Yes. Atlantis did not fall. Atlantis was flooded.
Okay. Mm. And of course, Atlantis has to be us, because guess what? First means first, so that is African.
And there were many Atlantises. We have one in the Pacific Ocean.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we have them off of Philippines. We have them all over any place where there was a beach before is now under 200, 300 feet of water.
Mm.
So the whole planet changed because of this. And because of that, a lot of the, most of the great civilizations, I won't say most of them, but many of the civilizations were along the water because they didn't have planes back then.
Mm-hmm.
They only had So the port, the places that the cities start to proliferate, okay? So when you have that flood, it ruins maybe 80 to 95% of the large centers, and those people die and die off. And there are only a few of them left to repopulate those areas that are depopulated. Okay? This is why this great phenomenal civilization of Zeb Tepe was destroyed, but there were a few people there still in Egypt, which is in a higher area, okay, who were able to hold on and do their thing, but it took thousands of years to come back to that point. And Egypt was not the first, it was the last gigantic, wonderful, great civilization, the very last of the phenomenal civilizations. Like I said,
that in itself is phenomenal, you know, because we think it's Egypt is first, or Kemet, right. And Kemet was last. There were, that's, oh, okay. Whew. Yep, got to have a cigar and scotch tonight, people. All right. Yep, I got to sit back and gloat on this one. It's like, yep, man, we had a conversation. We did a damn thing, man. Okay, so what are you doing next week, Doc? I got to have you back on the show, man, quick, because this is something we got to keep going. This is absolutely amazing. Did I leave anything off? Because I want to talk about and give people the ability to go and get this course. The free course, 5-day e-course, and to get the chapter. So obviously, you know, this is on YouTube. So in the description, there's a link. You can go there and boom, you'll see Professor Dr. Imhotep, and you will be able to immediately download, I think it's about 13 or 14 pages of the new introduction to the book, which in itself is like, a documentation. Now, can you imagine just taking that introduction to school when you have to turn in a class assignment about history? Oh, I would just love to be a fly on the wall for that. I would just, oh my God, I'd pay money. I'd pay money for somebody to just say, here, let me take this into class because we're talking about they're going to be doing a Native American thing. Let me bring this in and just shut them down. And then you've got the 5-day e-course to back it up. You go ahead on with your bad self. I ain't upset with you at all. I ain't mad. thank you, Doc, for your contribution to this planet. Thank you for showing up in the world at this time. We need you. We honor you. We respect you. We see you. For the people watching this show, I remember watching Jamie Foxx tell the story about when Oprah said, Jamie, you're blowing it. You're about to mess it up. I think you're going to win this Oscar for Ray. And she took him to Quincy Jones' house. And she says, are you ready to meet the person that you came here to meet? And he says, yeah. And she pointed over in the corner and she said, there he is. And it was Sidney Poitier. And Sidney Poitier said to Jamie, your work grew me 2 inches. Right?
Oh, wow.
Yeah, man. And so I'm saying that today, I've had many historical moments on my show and many historical conversations. My brother, and I'm pretty sure I'm speaking to the people who are watching this also, you have grown us 2 inches today. And I honor you and thank you so very much. Whatever sacrifices you've made, This is it, and I so appreciate you for it.
It's not me; it's my ancestors. I take no.
Yes, Ashe, I'm with you.
My ancestors.
Yes. So that being said, as we sign off, I think I'm gonna start a new closing and say whatever it is that you want to accomplish or achieve, in this new world. Don't give up, don't let up, and don't shut up until the ancestors take you up. We'll see you next time on the Philippe Matthews Show Live. Take care, everybody. Stick around with me, Doc, in the green room so we can get this next show scheduled.